about our experience about migrating a system. Well, this was the original title for this talk, but I was thinking that maybe a better title would be this, and how to survive to a rewrite. So today I want to talk about four points. The first one is where, giving you a little context about the system, about the problem. Next, we want to talk about what we did and what we're trying to do in order to resolve the problem that we have. And at the end, I want to talk about some conclusions and hope that can be very useful for you. So, where? Okay. I'm from Mexico, and maybe you know Mexico because of the tacos. So I bring this this picture in order to give you some idea about the variety that we have right now and some places and the kind of food that you can find there. Of course, we also have here this is a place that the name is Xochimilco, and the name of those boats are chinampas. So if you want, you can go and you can drink and do have a party up there. We also have nice places like this one that the name is Oaxaca. We have a lot of culture. Of course, you know the pyramids. That's one of the most typical places. But we also have this is downtown in Mexico City. We also have put sometimes crazy things like baseball area in the Zocalo, that's the name, in downtown. We also of course have new buildings and great architecture. But I think that for us is the most important thing is that we have as today one of the largest groups of Elixir in the world. I'm very pleased to be part of that. And well, in fact, in October, we are going to have the second Erlang factory light in Mexico City. Of course, for us, it was also really surprising like the last year, because we sold out in 3 weeks. That was crazy. And I'm really happy because of the community. We can see that right now here, that we are a lot of people here. And this year is going to be in this venue. In this venue, we are going to have the conference. So, of course, everyone is invited to be there in exactly 2 months. So, okay, talking about the context. In Mexico, we have a law about doing everything right now using electronic invoices. Everything started in that year, and right now it's mandatory. No, 2 years ago was mandatory that any transaction, everything that you do right now in Mexico needs to have an electronic invoice. And that's more or less the amount of people, the total tax payers that we have in Mexico. And the government right now is pushing supporting more documents, for example, beer certificates. They are trying very hard to put everything in an electronic way. So it's going to be more and more important to have systems that support that kind of demand. This is a statistic about, for example, the transactions, the number of transactions that we have right now. Well, this one was exactly 1 year ago, at the end of the last year, we were there. The name of the company, Diversa. Yeah, and at the end of this year, we are going to be there. So more or less, we have like we're going to have those millions of transactions by the end of the year. The company has that amount of users, and more or less we have 44 transactions per second. So maybe a lot of you are going to take right now, well, that's not a lot, right? When we know about Erlang, we almost hear about that you can manage a lot of transactions. So 44 transactions, it's not a big deal, right? We can do maybe with another systems, but then why? Why use Elixir? For us, was more about availability of the system and more about cost reduction. Yeah, those are were the most problematic things that we have in that moment. For example, for our clients, it's a very critical part of the process. Yeah, you need to deliver the invoices online on time. Yeah, the clients can lose money, a lot of money, if you don't deliver, for example, the invoices on time. Yeah. Also, the tax authority that is the SAT has heavy fines if you don't deliver the documents. Yeah, for the client, and in the case of us, some statistics and reports that we need to give to the authority. Yeah, so the system needs to be available all the time. Yeah. Any date, any time, yeah. And the last one, we were paying a lot of money for infrastructure, yeah. The system was a Java system, and we have, well, if you see the bill at the end of the month, you're really going to be scared about the amount of money that we need to pay for that. To support the operation. This is the growth that we had in the last years. We start here, more or less like in the middle of that year. We start working. We were there in the company. We start working in the company, and that was the volume of transactions. So you see, we got a lot of growth in the last 3 years. It was really, really crazy. The invoicing process is really simple. Yeah, you need just to receive the request from the clients, validate credentials, payment status for those clients. After that, you need to validate the document or the data that they give you. For example, you need to check structure, you need to check some business rules. Of course, there are a lot of them. Then you need to create the invoice that you need. There is a format that you need to follow, and there are very, very specific rules about the characteristics of that document. So you need to create the document. After that, you do a digital signature for that document, and then you need to deliver that document to the authority, to the client, and that's it. Yeah. So it looks simple, and it's really, really simple, the flow. But the business rules that you need to check, for example, for the document, can be very, very, very complicated. So, once upon a time, yeah, we arrived to the company. and we found this one. Yeah. First, we have a system in the world they want to find the Java servers that expose some web services, especially using SOAP. We have as the database manager SQL server, and we also have a hardware security module that where we store the private keys for that the authority gives us as an authority to create the digital signature. So we need to follow that rule. We cannot store that certificate in a server. It needs to be in a very specific hardware, in this case, this appliance, this hardware security module. And we have two different kind of clients. One is a batch, clients that needs batch processing, and other ones that use online processing. For the batch processing, we also have a program, and that program was also written in Java. Yeah, so you give that program to the client, and the client install that system in their servers, and they can start reading the documents, the data, and then start sending that information to our services. Yeah, that was really a really really pain to maintain and support, because you need to check for, in the case of the clients, you don't have control about the infrastructure, so sometimes you have problems because the Java virtual machine is not the correct version, or the operating system, or the libraries, so it was really, really, really a pain to maintain that part. This was the configuration for the servers. So that you can have an idea about the servers that we have. We have two physical servers with these characteristics. We have a lot of Java servers with also this configuration. Yeah, and when we arrive, we say, what? Windows Server and Apache. Oh my God. No, I really was not expecting that, no? Because you normally expect, I don't know, Apache running in Linux, on Linux, and if you have Windows, well, you are running the Microsoft web server, but that's a really, really weird configuration. But this is good. We did some tests in order to check the Java system and his behavior, and we found that when we start to stress the system, it crashes. We were really really scared, yeah, because as you remember in the graph, we in that moment we start to get more and more and more clients, more transactions, and we saw this and say, oh my God, we have a problem. Yeah, and yeah, we have a lot of problems. Yeah, we saw that the system had a lot of downtimes because of memory leaks, and also because of manual deployments. We have multiple copies of the system. Yeah, literally copies, yeah, in different servers. Yeah, and the main reason for that was to manage crashes. Yeah, and isolate those crashes. Of course, those copies were not synchronized, of course. So some of them have very different versions of the system running. Some of them with months of difference. Was crazy, and of course that consumes a lot of resources, no? Because you have a lot of copies of this exactly the same system. So of course we have the normal problems. We have a lot of problems trying to fix bugs or adding new features or testing. Yeah, the testing cycle was very, very long because everything was also manual, right? D1 was also very bad because we inside the system we found that we have a lot of very general rules mixed together with the client with clients' requirements. Yeah, so some clients say, okay, I want to have this validation for my invoices, but those specific rules were mixed with the general ones. So if you want to modify and do something about the business rules, you are going to need a lot of luck to avoid some problems deploying the system. We also have a very old Java library that we were using FOP for PDF generation, and that's a very, believe me, very old version of the library. And of course, it has memory leaks, have a lot of problems. So, and in general, we have embedded libraries everywhere. So, what were we thinking when we saw all of these things? Of course, first, yeah, say, please, yeah, and we feel. Of course, I went to my boss and explained and say, how can I tell you that we have a very, very big problem? So the next question is, well, what we did? Yeah, what we did with all of these things? So of course, the first thing was this, yeah? I also talked to my boss and say, well, of course we need to rewrite, right? That everything is wrong, we need to start from scratch, yeah? Everything will be okay, yeah? But we know that story, yeah? Right. Why? Yeah, because of this. Yeah. We love technology, of course. No, that's I think that's why we are here. And almost every time it's nice to try something new. Yeah, in this case, Elixir or Erlang. Well, Erlang is not new, but we want to do something different. And of course, the first idea is to rewrite everything. But we know that it's going to be hard. It's going to be very difficult to try to replace a legacy system, especially a system that is in production for a very long time. We are talking about more or less 10 years working that system. That system, of course, has a lot of patches, bugs that were fixes in the correct moment. It's going to be hard to replace that system and taking into account every edge case, no? We have the advice, for example, from Joel and Sonver, that they told us about that. You need to be very careful about thinking about rewrite everything from scratch. Yeah, and we also know about this, right? We also know that we know about the Hydra effect, no? So you start with the legacy system, and then you start from scratch, and you end with two legacy systems, no? And then now you have two problems, no? And you have to maintain these two systems, and it's going to be a real, real problem. So the next question is, do we really need to rewrite everything? Mm-hmm. Okay. we ask that question and we decide to follow this strategy, okay? First, fix as much as possible the old system, yeah? Don't give up, yeah? Have some hope about the system and say that, well, maybe it's not so bad. Maybe I can find a way to fix this thing, okay? But in the meantime, I'm going to start to prepare, yeah? And in this case, start the training with the team, yeah? Start working with the team, doing some work with Erlang and Elixir for the team, and that try to do that simultaneously. Second, replace the Java client with a Go program. Yeah, I'm going to talk more about that. And start small projects in Erlang and Elixir. Yeah, some programs that they are not critical for the operation. Yeah, but can be very useful in order to understand better the technology, especially for the team. So we start doing that. Next, yeah, start the big rewrite if you still need it. Yeah, after we try to fix the old system as much as possible, and then evaluate and find if we really need to change everything. Well, okay, we are going to be ready, no? Because we did the training, we did the pet projects, or we did some small projects to also give us more experience about what we can do. And the last one, of course, yeah, get fired. Yeah, so sounds like a good plan, right? So I say, well, okay, let's try it. How long can it take? What can go wrong? Yeah? We are very optimistic here, no? So it's a line, it's Elixir. Everything will be fine. So we start fixing the Java system. Okay? And we made some changes to the system in order to support the new load. Yeah. And the team that was responsible for that part was did a really, really good job at the moment. We started updating most of the libraries, operating systems, application servers, everything. Yeah, we reworked some parts, some small parts that we evaluate and say, no, those parts are really, really bad. We need to try to encapsulate those parts and rewrite everything inside, yeah, and replace those modules. We also improved the deployment system. It was really, really crazy how the things were. They, for example, in the case of the Java system, they before they were taking the class files and moving those class files by hand and putting those files into production. No jar, no. They also have a change in the data center. Please don't do that. Especially when you are trying to fix a system. Was a really nightmare. Was a nightmare of more or less like six months that all the team was really, really suffering because of a lot of dependencies, a lot of things that we didn't know about the existence of those dependencies. We especially have a problem with some clients that use a specific version of a protocol, and when we try to move the systems from one data center to another, we start to receive complaints from some clients saying that they can connect, they couldn't connect to the system. And we say, why? Because it's the same. It's, but when we check the configuration of some protocols in the data center, we found that there was a very different version of that protocol in the new data center. So that was the problem. We need to go back to the other one. No, that's a nightmare. So we also removed some of the copies. We were able to remove some of the copies of the system and try to centralize some logic in just one services. And the good part is that we were able to manage the growth from the next 2 years, using the old system. So we were fine. We more or less resolved some of the problems that we had. Okay, that was about the services. The other really, really pain that we had was the client in Java. So we decided to use Go for that part, and for those reasons. It's very easy to deploy. You can, in just one binary, we include, for example, SQLite, a web server, everything inside the binary that was more or less like a megabytes of size. So for the client, it was very easy just to copy the file and put it on the server, and that's it. No external dependencies, no problems with the version of the operating systems. That's nice. And well, Go has good support for concurrency. It's very, very fast. So that's okay. And well, we don't need high availability. So it's fine. For Go it's fine. I don't have any problem using Go in that part. We started doing the training for the team. We created a 2 days course, and we gave that for free for 1.5 years. And we have more or less like 100 people in the classes. So it was a very nice experience trying to teach Elixir and Erlang to more people. Now we have a 7 day course. That is nice. And we create the Mexico City Elixir group. And more or less on that time. And also has been a very, very great experience. We start with the small projects. We create a proxy using Dynamo just before Balloon announced that it was deprecated. So we said, Jose, we loved you. Thank you. But well, later we replaced that one with Phoenix, so say, okay, we're fine, no problem. And I think that's one of the good things about starting with the small projects, because was built after Dynamo was deprecated, we can replace that part with Phoenix very, very quickly. So no real problem with that. We also have an hardware secure module emulator that is in GitHub. I can give you the repo, the link of the repo. That is very nice because we, Erlang and of course Elixir is awesome for implementing binary protocols. So we were able to implement an emulator of the appliance of the real hardware. So we can remove that dependency from development and from testing, because we implemented the complete binary protocol for the clients. So when you, for example, want to start the development for the system, you can check out the, you can clone the complete repository, and you can start the system, and that system is going to also run the emulator, and then you can start to send in the messages and do everything like the real one. So that was great, because now the team can have everything inside the machine. We also do some changes in order to support Postgres and SQL Server. So for development, we use Postgres. When we deploy, we use SQL Server. So that was also great, because all the team has, for example, Macs. So it was very hard to create the virtual machine, install SQL Server, and blah, blah, blah. So we just put me the adapter for Postgres, and we were fine doing everything with Postgres, and then for QA and production, we can use SQL Server, and everything was okay. Yeah. Okay, next. The time for the big rewrite. First, we had luck, honestly, because the authority defined a new version for the invoice standard. Yeah, that was the best news that I can get in my life, because awesome. All the clients need to upgrade their systems for the new format. So it's the perfect time for doing this. Yeah, it's the perfect time. Yeah? And of course, we still have problems, no? With calls, with slow development cycles, yeah? So we will start creating a team of 5 people to doing the development stuff, 1 working on the deployment stuff, and 2 more doing the testing design and test automation. Yeah. In this case, for example, in the case of the tests, we have two persons that have had a lot of experience doing design for testing. Yeah, the cases, everything, and they learn Elixir. So they were the people that did everything about the automation. So that was really, I think that was good to do that. We wrote a first version in 6 months with a part-time team in just 1 Phoenix app. Yeah? So, of course that was wrong. Yeah? So we rewrote the system 1 time to use OTP. Yeah? So we start to split the system, yeah, using OTP, and start to say, okay, well, yeah, it's not, again, Phoenix is not your architecture, it's not your the way that you need to define everything of your system. So we start to put some parts in OTP and just isolate Phoenix in one part. And we do another change in order to support umbrella projects, yeah, and isolate more Phoenix. And that one was really great, because that took just 1 week. Yeah, because we have, for that time, we had a lot of tests. Yeah, so in just 1 week, we were able to do those, all the changes, and everything was working, yeah, as normal. And today we were really happy because of Chris' keynote announcement about he talked about how to separate Phoenix and you have the support for the umbrella projects. Well, we did some very similar thing in the system. You are going to see that architecture right now. So this was the previous system, and now we have this. Mm-hmm. So now we have the web services in Elixir. We are using ports for calling Python and C library for XML schema validation. We still use the Java part for PDF creation. The reason of that is because we have a lot of templates using that version of the library, and it's really that, and it's going to take us a lot of time to migrate those templates. So that's why we decided don't do that. We also have the emulator, and of course SQL Server, and the normal appliance, and the web client. Internally, with the system, you're going to find that part is just the one related to Phoenix. Yeah. Everything else is just OTP and modules, normal modules. Yeah. So we have the request. Phoenix receives that request. Then we go for through the document router, the validations, the invoicing process, the signature, the electronic signature, and then we deliver the documents. And so we have very defined models to do all those parts. Those are the servers. Now with Linux, and this is the final timeline. Yeah. It just took 3 years. Remember? So this is the more or less the time and the main events during the last 2 years. And right now we are doing the deployment in production. In fact, we're going to support very important client right now in Mexico, Mexico City. And we are very happy because we were doing some tests and some benchmarks, and the results are really, really great. So the last part. Okay, so the new system. So the PDF generation still uses Java. Okay. But we no longer use application servers. Yeah. So now it's very easy to deploy also that part. And we invoke that service from Elixir, and it's working fine. For the schema validation for XMLs, we use as I said, a Python library and Erlang ports. We are getting better performance and latency, and portals for development and SQL Server in production. For deployment, we are using Ansible and Erlang releases. And we have right now a test suite of about almost 1,000 tests. Yeah, and it's really great because it takes just 5 minutes. 5 minutes to run, and we test a lot of cases, creating documents, checking the validations, checking the digital signatures, errors, almost everything. So now if we need to do a change, we can just run all the test suites, and we can be okay that everything will be fine. We can also develop and test everything without any external dependency. And we also create a single sign-on service, also in Elixir. Yeah, that was another side project. And now that single sign-on service is used by other applications, internal systems. One is in PHP. Don't laugh, please. And the other ones in Rails, and there are a lot of internal systems that we have also. We get the flexibility to add new requirements. No memory leaks, yeah. We also have a centralized error management system. And the last one, yeah. We just check the amount of code that we have in the old Java system versus the new one, and we found that, yeah. So that's nice, no? A lot less of cost that we need to be maintained. So we're also very happy with that. This is a graph showing the Java version, and this is the Erlang and Elixir version. So with less resources, especially memory, yeah. So it's nice. Remember that graph? Okay, very different one. Yeah, so we're also fine with this. In the servers, we have right now two cores, and of course, Erlang is using all of them. We are using, in fact, less than 1 gigabyte of memory for in doing those tests. Okay. Final words. It can take a long time to do these kind of things, so be prepared. Yeah. You will need support. Yeah, from all the team. You need to define that training path. Team really loves Elixir. Yeah. Java developers, Ruby developers, PHP developers, when they start to learn and understand the advantage and the things that Elixir can give you, they really love Elixir. Be patient. Yeah, sometimes you need to wait for the right time, see? But you need to be ready for that moment. Yeah, and you're going to support the old system for a long period of time. Yeah. It is awesome for the new protocols. Also, you don't need to trash everything, yeah, from the old system. So be open to reuse legacy codes. Sometimes you can trash, yeah, so, but that's fine. And this one, Erlang is good to orchestrate other systems. So, for example, in the case of Python, we are using ports. So, when we start the system in Erlang, the Erlang system start to create operating system processes containing the Python program, and then we send messages between the processes from Erlang to Python, and everything is okay with the schema validation. So we start from one innovative project to going crazy with different repos, and finally using umbrella projects. I think that umbrella projects are awesome. So don't be afraid of changing direction and make big change. And more or less, I think that 4 months is okay to have someone to understand and use OTP. That's our experience. Yeah, I think that more or less is the time. So, thank you very much, and hope to see you in Mexico.